All right, next we'll have Chris Brennan. Chris is an attorney in New Jersey and is very interested in the family law issues, and I'm just going to let him take it away.
Yeah, I am an attorney in New Jersey. I do not do divorce law, and I'm going to get into that a little bit later on as I speak, because the fact that there are people like me who do not do divorce law is actually what we're starting to find is part of the problem. Because what has happened is that the field has been ceded to the sharks. And as Jeff was just saying, and I was so glad when I first talked to Jeff, I have never called a family lawyer a lawyer. I call them anti-family lawyers. And I have pretty much, and I've written about this, I consider divorce attorneys to be the abortionists of the legal profession, and make no mistake about it, that is what they are. Now, I want to talk about some of the developments that we've had in law, and we've really started to see this in some of the gay marriage cases, where what the courts have done is they have essentially adopted the idea that any relationship where there are romantic feelings or, strong feelings, let's call it a marriage. That's essentially what a lot of the gay marriage has been about. And there's a problem with that. And it really, we've all heard the expression, well, love is love. Well, that's really a cheap saying, and I think we all know that. But it has consequences in the what we know to be actual marriage cases, because once you start saying love is love and romantic feelings are the basis of a marriage, what is the and that we should start basing our jurisprudence and our enforcement of marriage based on romantic feelings, why can't we just say, well, once the romantic feelings are gone, we should dissolve the marriage? And once you say that, what is the difference between a marriage and a high school crush? And that's where we're at. And it's not thinking, it's not logic. So, Jeff says we got to get into the legislatures, and I agree with him. I also agree, and I'm hoping we're going to hear some of this from Matt, who, by the way, we've got to find a way to get him to law school.
Amen. Absolutely.
All right. I have been practicing law for 20 years. I am not a constitutional attorney. I talked to Matt about constitutional law, and I'm amazed at what this man, this young man, knows about constitutional law. So we got to get him to law school. But when we get into legislatures, so we've lost this definition of what is a marriage. I'd like to propose a couple definitions. They're not mine. I'll read them, and then I'll tell you where they come from. And one is that the spouse's union achieves the twofold end of marriage: the good of the spouses themselves and the transmission of life. So marriage should exist for the good of both the spouses, and it involves children. The two meanings or values of marriage cannot be separated without altering the couple's spiritual life and compromising the goods of marriage. And some of those goods are, companionship, the spiritual goods, the emotional support, and then also, very simply, the assets, the stuff you accumulate. So the values of marriage cannot be separated without altering the spiritual life and compromising the goods of marriage and the future of the family. The conjugal love of man and woman thus stands under the twofold obligation of fidelity, lifelong fidelity. That's always either implied or expressed. And those of us that have been married in religious ceremonies, that is an express promise for life. It takes on, marriage is a lot of things, but one of the things it takes on is the dimensions of a contract, and I'll talk about that a little bit. And fecundity. So it's the twofold obligation of fidelity and fecundity, children. Now, another thing we want to bring, and we've got to push and get this into legislatures, is what's the problem with divorce? Divorce is immoral also because it introduces disorder into the family and into society. Now, I will tell you, we have always known always that divorce introduces disorder into society. Dr. Morse talked a little bit about it last night. We figured, well, in the sexual revolution, we can just kind of re-engineer things to suit our purposes and, you know, have romantic relationships however we want. But we've always known this, and we've got to get back and fight this battle. This disorder brings grave harm to the deserted spouse, to the children traumatized by the separation of their parents and often torn between them, and because of the contagious effect, which makes it truly a plague on society. Does anybody know where those definitions come from? They were for thousands of years the teaching of the Catholic Church. That comes straight out of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And I would propose to you that they are good definitions, even for Protestants, for Jews, for Muslims, wherever. They are an excellent definition. That's what we're talking about. We are facing a moral problem that has to be written into the law. And don't ever forget, every law has a moral dimension. You know, our frankly, our adversaries on the left like to say, well, you can't legislate morality. Well, we know that's nonsense. They try to legislate morality all the time. Their morality. And let's never forget, we're right and they're wrong. We are not equal ideas. We are not equal ideas in what academia will call the marketplace of ideas. We need to win. And that's why these conferences are so important. And frankly, as far as I know, the Ruth Institute is the only organization that I know that has seriously taken on the problem of divorce within the context of the sexual revolution. Now, what are some concrete proposals? I've got 3 minutes left. Mrs. Davis touched on some of these things that I talk about, but that's okay. One thing is we've got to understand the law as a teacher. One thing we have learned is that if you want to regulate conduct, and I'm an economist by training, one of the great ways to regulate conduct is to regulate the economic consequences of conduct. The leftists and the sexual revolutionaries know this very well. In Obamacare, we saw this. You're going to pay for their contraception, or damn it, they're going to bankrupt you. Well, we need to start applying some of that thinking for our side. Like I said, it's because we're right, and the stuff we're trying to protect is right. So one thing I would propose is that in the context of a no-fault divorce, which is a unilateral divorce, it is a breaking of a contract. It's a breach of a contract. It's more than that, but one of the things is it's a breach of a contract. So as a modest proposal, I would suggest that if you say you're going to breach the contract, treat it like any other contract that we do in commercial litigation, which is my background. You breach a contract, you're not going to benefit from that breach. You're not entitled to alimony, you're not entitled to child support, and not only that, you may end up paying child support or compensation to the party who did not file. There's nothing that says you can't introduce that as a statutory solution and build the momentum, and it is going to take work. And we've got guys like Jeff that have been spending time in Austin. We could do this in Trenton. A lot of you may not know, New Jersey was one of the last states to have no-fault divorce. As liberal as we are up there, we were one of the very last states. So we could do that. You cannot have a relationship where parties enter into it and one party gets to exit it, taking all the assets and leaving all the liabilities. You could simply write a statute that says you file for no fault, you're automatically precluded from some of these benefits. Something Ms. Davis brought up that I think is essential: punish perjury. In New Jersey, if you, in any kind of civil litigation context, if you submit a tax return in evidence, whether it's in a business dispute or even in the anti-family law court, the court is required to refer that false tax return to the taxing authorities for potential prosecution. It's automatic. In a lot of jurisdictions, there's a lot of discretion to that and so on. But for some reason, it's only limited to tax returns. There are other blatant cases of perjury that occur in the family law courts, anti-family law courts. Punish them. Refer them out to the county prosecutor or the district attorney and let them get prosecuted. Now, the prosecutors may not take it, but start doing it. We can write a statute that says it's getting automatically referred. Let's do that. It'll give the divorce attorneys something to chew on. Lastly, and unfortunately, because I was originally going to have a 20-minute talk, I'm shortened here. My time's already out, and I'll wrap up. Punish sexual infidelity in marriage. A lot of people are not aware of this. We do have in the United States, in 8 states, there is a type of lawsuit called alienation of affections. We used to have it. It used to be a common law cause of action, meaning it was handed on down from merry old England, and we had it for a long time. And what alienation of affection lawsuit is, someone takes on a mistress or, a man or a woman commits adultery. You can, and destroys a marriage thereby. You can go after that person and sue them for damages. In North Carolina, there are 200 such lawsuits every year. And let me tell you, those judgments are big money, millions of dollars. And I will tell you, we need to start restoring those in other states. And practically speaking, you're not going to have a very hard time convincing the plaintiff's trial bar to bring another cause of action back where they can get multi-million dollar judgments. And the other effect is, if someone starts hearing, oh man, I may get whacked with a multi-million dollar judgment, they may keep their pants on. Now lastly, and I have run over, I'll just say, we do need attorneys. And if you want to get them in touch with me, that's fine. You can get them in touch with me through the Ruth Institute. We've got to start getting them organized where they can defend hapless defendants and start suing states for unconstitutional procedures. Dr. Baskerville listed a lot of these unconstitutional consequences that go on in divorces, and they are happening to people. They are defenseless. And the reason is, people like me look at anti-family law and say, well, we don't want any part of that. Well, I'm saying, you know what, we got to get in that. We got to get in that. We have associations that defend pro-lifers' First Amendment rights. We have legal associations that defend homeschoolers' Fourth Amendment rights. But no one's defending the innocent spouse's constitutional rights in divorce cases. We got to start doing that. As Jeff said, we got to do something. As Dr. Morris said, you get a bunch of people together, you build a movement, and you can get this changed. The ACLU started out as a total wacko organization. I mean, they're still wacko. but they were not respected. And when they started out, they had loss after loss after loss after loss. And then some of those ideas started to take. But we need to do the same thing. I am a New Jersey lawyer. I like street fights. And that's what we got to get. We got to get attorneys that want to do street fighting. Thank you.